Thank you, Denise. Good morning. Welcome to Jackson Friends Church. We have some sun out there. At least we had it earlier. I don't know. Let's all stand and let's worship the Lord together. So from Psalm 18, verses 2 and 3, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. I call upon the Lord, and I am saved from my enemies.
Bye. you're seated, would you greet one another in the Lord? Good morning. Good morning again. It's good to have you here at Jackson Friends Church. Hey, we have a great update that we want to share. If I can bring up Leah, who is our kids ministry director. Make sure to turn that on there. She has a great update about the event that we did right before Easter called Spring Fling.
Hello, hello. Okay, so as you know, we had our big Easter event that we have every year. I got a couple of pictures here for us. This here's our face painting that's happening. This year, we had over 200 people. After COVID, obviously, we had little to none. And then our first year back, we had 50, and then it went to about 100. And last year, we had 150, and this year, we had just over 200. So it is consistently growing. I do believe that the reason it's growing is because it is so blessed. When I came in here years ago and looked at all the events that we do and how they run, this was the one that I think was always the most important, but it thrived. And I think it thrives because it's blessed and because we have so many volunteers. You guys always come out. I don't even have to ask questions. People show up. We had new volunteers this year, people that I hadn't met yet. It was great to see some of the new families that came out to volunteer. That was awesome. We have a lot of donations that we get. Our ladies group, they do phenomenal. If you paid attention to the headcount of the eggs, when I started, there was about 5,000. Then it went to 7. And then this year, we hit 8,000. So the kids love seeing all the extra eggs. But our ladies Bible group does that. It's awesome. They have it figured out. They come in on Tuesday. They do everything for us, and it is just phenomenal. They pack the eggs, because that's the thing. They don't just pack the eggs. They have to find all the pieces and parts, put them together, make sure they fit, and then they count them into bags of 100 so that they know how many we actually put out. So it is a huge, huge blessing. The other thing is the candy donations. Thank you to everyone who's given us that candy, because we use it. The kids love it, and we have some pictures of that too. This here is one of the donations that we got. If you go back to the, yep, there it is. We stopped doing all the little prizes. We used to do where kids could, I came with my kids, and they'd go through that back room and they would have like, everybody walked out with like 10 things. It was a long line and it was a lot of stuff. So we decided that we would start getting donations from different local businesses. So we got like a birthday party to the bowling alley. Someone got 5 tickets to the MAPS Museum. Baseball lessons, ice skating lessons, just really cool things for them to go do with their family. So this year we had 11 of those donated. This here was one of the things that got donated to us that was super special. We decided we wanted to do Bible Buddies. So what it is it's kind of like Build-A-Bear. You come in, you adopt one, you get to take it home with you, you name it and do the whole thing. And then there's a sheet that gives you your first 14 days of how to read your Bible with your Bible Buddy. So I put out to some of the women here in church, just a group of us, said, hey, does anyone know where we can get stuffed animals? They're not cheap, but we need stuffed animals. And by the end of the day, I had someone reach out and say, I got 150 of them for you. I'll drop them off. So I'm like, how do we get 150 stuffed animals just like that? So I reached out and I found out that there was a mom from one of her son died in the Tuskegee Valley bus accident. This is her new thing. So she has on Facebook, it's called A Boy and a Hippo. And it's where he went to Disney, and he brought back a stuffed animal from there. And he was always goofing off with it. And she just loved all the pictures of him with his stuffed animal. So now she gets people to donate stuffed animals, and she sends them out in his name just to help kids be a little happier, put a smile on their face. So that's where these all came from. So we had a huge, a lot of people loved this. Like, this was a really big spot. And then a couple of people who didn't have Bibles, we told them we'd get them a Bible. So we got a couple of kids that were sending Bibles out to. So that was a really cool new little thing that we had there. The next one was just our eggs. all of our fun eggs. There's our 8,000 eggs. But just a thank you to everybody. We had the coffee house, the counters, everybody. It's a great event. So if you haven't been to it, I highly recommend. And this was your first one.
It was my first one, and I loved it. I got to share the gospel through resurrection eggs to multiple kids and their families. Mama says, hearing about Jesus and the story of the resurrection and what that hope gives through the resurrection eggs. It was awesome. It was fun.
We had a lot of sports families that showed up. Right. I've seen a couple of sports families. I had family that came up because their church is just too small. They don't have a lot of kids' activities. So we had a lot of people show up.
Yeah, that don't normally come to church
here. Yeah,
it was so great. Thank you, Leah, so much for all you do. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah, and of course, you can look at your bulletin. There's a lot of announcements there about what's happening here at the church. A lot of things that are happening and ways to get involved and a way to spread the good news and the love of Jesus to more people. We have a fun event that's happening next Sunday, our chili cook-off and night of worship. Please plan to be there. That's going to be a fun time of just fellowship and really even encouragement as we gather together to sing songs of worship. Worship of Christ. And then also, I want to bring it to your attention, baptism. If you are interested in being baptized, if you go to our website, jacksonfriends.org, click on events there, fill out the form there to let us know that you're interested. Maybe you've made that commitment to follow Jesus, and really the next step is to get baptized, to follow in our Lord Jesus' footsteps by getting baptized and identifying with Him that we are His. And so if you are interested, please go to our website and sign up there to be baptized there. So also, we have another special thing that we're going to do here. And I'd like to invite all of our new members that just recently took the new members club to come up forward here. We want to present them to the church. So all of those new members, would you come up here and stand up here? And I think, Lori, if you can come and up and also help me. We had a membership class not too long ago, a couple months ago, and that they went through the class, and they also, when they go through the class, they learn about what we do here at the church, our mission, our belief, and then how they can really connect to the church and make a commitment to say, yes, I want to commit to this church as my church home, to say, I want to serve and be in that. So we present them. If you could also put up the slide of the members that weren't able to be here. There's a couple of them that weren't able to be, but we had 11 new church members that are making this commitment. And as a kind of a token of our appreciation, we have a flower, but also a certificate to let them know that you are a member of our church. And maybe this spurs on something in your heart that you would like to be a member. I would encourage you to take the connection card in the pew back in front of you, fill it out there, check the little box that says membership, and you can either put it in the offering today or put it at the welcome desk there in the foyer to let us know that you would like to be a member, to commit to this church and to learning about what we as a church are about, our mission, our value, our vision, and to connect into that. We appreciate that. But I want to publicly thank these new members. And to pray for them. So let's pray together. God, thank you for each one here on this platform and even those who are not with us that have made the commitment to make Jackson Friends Church as their local church that they would serve and build into. And I pray, Father, that you would use these new members for your purposes and glory here in this local church to, Father, bring about your goodness and love through them. And to help them, Father, to even grow greater in the knowledge of you, to be a disciple of you. Strengthen them in that as they serve here at Jackson Friends. We ask your blessing upon them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Jordan. So now if our ushers could come forward to receive our offering, I'd appreciate that. Again, a part of our worship is our giving to the Lord. God has entrusted to us, you know, resources and treasures that we give in order to continue to make His name great. And that's what we do with our offering here today, that we give of that so that we can make His name great and His gospel to spread, not only here in our local community, but around the world. So let's pray. Father, thank you for all the things that you give into our lives. We know that what we have, it's not from us alone, but it is from you. And Lord, now in this offering time, we give back. Lord, we want to honor you with the things that you have entrusted us with to make your name great, to spread your good news, oh Lord Jesus, here through this church and beyond. Would you bless this offering as we take this morning? In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. reflection, I want everyone just to have this moment and sit in the presence of the Lord. What an awesome God you had served. When we went through this week, we celebrated an event that was said to be coming to pass, and it happened. And glory to God, the clouds rolled away a little bit to give us a clear shot of seeing what was a total eclipse. Awesome. When you look in the scriptures, I want you to just reflect with me, if you will, as the prophet Isaiah shares this revelation. He says this to us, "Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all of these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing." This was such an awesome event. Marie was sharing that she had tears in her eyes. Others of you were saying just how awesome it was. How could you not believe in God Almighty? Because that's general revelation. It's throughout all his creation reflecting our God's handiwork. And as we come here today, what's so special about this is that he knows you. Special revelation in Jesus Christ has come to show that God's love, just like every one of those stars out there that he names, and now they're talking billions and billions of galaxies. So as we reflect on that, God is bigger. God knows each of them. Calls them out by name, knows each of us, desires to call us out by name. As we go to prayer today, I want you to take to heart that we serve an awesome God who loves each and every one of you and takes the time to touch our lives to show us his love. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for each and every individual here and listening to the message, that you would just touch our hearts with the knowledge that you know us one by one, just as you set those stars in place. You care about us and who we are, where we go, and that we know you. We just truly pray that there would continue to be light into our paths and just exhilaration in our heart as we see in creation the magnificence of the timing and integration of things, the harmony, the coordination that the heavens spoke of this week. We just rejoice in being able to experience that and having you roll back the thick clouds so that we can see it all, Lord. We just pray that you would continue to draw us close to you. Receive our praise, Lord, as we give you a spirit of thanksgiving and rejoice in you. We pray all of this, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand one more time? As we sing this song, think of how Jesus was with his disciples, and they asked him, "How should we pray? Teach us to pray, Lord."
Deliver.
Let me continue that prayer as we just, what we sung. Lord, let your will be done in our hearts today. Lord, even as we now even open your word, Lord, let your will be done in us. Strengthen us to know. Open our eyes, open our ears to hear of you today. We love you, Lord. We thank you for all you give. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team, for leading us in song and worship, leading us. Thank you, Jordan. I appreciate, when we were singing the hymn, he was telling, let all the people rejoice. He was pointing to you all. I hope you were getting that encouragement. I know I was, Jordan, to praise the Lord this day that we would give to him. And every day we would praise the Lord and worship him. That's what we've come here to do this morning, to praise and to worship our Creator, the one who made the heavens, as John led us to see. It was truly a magnificent event that we got to see last Sunday in the eclipse. It was a beautiful sight, beautiful, beautiful sight to see. We are going to continue our series here this morning on seeing Christ through Peter's eyes, looking at the life of one of Jesus' disciples, Peter, and how he was affected by Christ through how he and how he came to learn about Jesus, our God, and really how Jesus affected this one man's life to understand for ourselves how he can affect our lives. I feel, we could get a little bit more intimate details of our God as we see him work through such a man like Peter, who had ups and downs in his life and in his faith journey with the Lord Jesus. So before I begin, though, I want to tell a little joke and that will kind of remind us what we learned last week about Peter. Now, I warn you, I've been told by some this is a bad joke. And so maybe just laugh out of courtesy, all right? So here we go. How do you think Peter felt when Jesus changed his name? How do you think Peter felt when Jesus changed his name? Solid. Like a rock. Come on, just give me a little laugh. Okay. Well, we learned that, right? Last week we learned that how Jesus looked at Simon and called him Peter, or Cephas in Aramaic, which means rock. And really to tell him of really kind of the plan that he had for Peter, that he was going to be a rock for the church, his people, to carry on this great message, this good news of the gospel of Jesus to others. So, let's look at, our passage today is going to be in Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 27. So if you have your Bibles, would you turn to Mark chapter 8? Starting there in verse 27, if you don't have a Bible, I would encourage you to use the Pew Bible that is in front of you, or flip on your device and turn to Mark chapter 8. And as I prayed earlier, that God would impact us with his word today. So let me pray again and just ask God to really impact us with his word. Father, please, would you now transform, change, and move us by your word, your very words to us. God, I'm always amazed to think that you have given us your very word so that we can know you. And so I pray today, would you speak through your words into our hearts, transform us and help us to be your people, living for you, doing your will as we prayed in that last song. Help us, O Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. So Mark chapter 8. Starting in verse 27. Would you follow along as I read verse 27 through 30? It says, And Jesus went on with his disciples to the village of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, Who do people say that I am? And they told him, John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others, one of the prophets. Verse 29, and he asked them, But who do you say that I am? Well, Peter answered, You are the Christ. And he strictly charged them not strictly charged them to tell no one about him. So, Jesus was traveling with his disciples to a village called Caesarea Philippi, and he asked them an important question. Who do you say that I am? Now, Caesarea Philippi was a city ruled by a man named Herod Philip. The city was primarily non-Jewish, known for its worship of Greek gods, and there was a big temple devoted to the ancient god Pan. And when Philip became the ruler, he rebuilt and renamed the city after Tiberius Caesar, the former Roman ruler, and himself. So that's why it's called Caesarea Philippi. So as Jesus and his disciples walked towards Caesarea Philippi, Jesus asked his disciples what they had heard from people regarding him. Jesus knew where he was, and he knew in such a place where there was much name recognition and the worship of other gods and religion, false religion that was part of the culture in this city of Caesarea Philippi. So Jesus asked this question to his disciples, who do people say that I am? Hoping to stir their hearts in such a place and get them thinking about what people are saying about Jesus, who has already been teaching about the kingdom of God, doing miracles among them. Many around them had allegiance to the ruler of the land and to the false gods that were around them. And now Jesus is asking his disciples, who do people say that I am? I believe there is only one question about God that we all have to wrestle with in life. And it's in regards, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus to you? Jesus Christ is not someone we can ignore. He is a historical figure that's recorded not only in the Bible, but other historical documents. Jesus made strong claims and proclamations of himself, like saying very intolerant and exclusive statements like, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me. It's a very intolerant and exclusive statement, especially in a culture where they are encouraged to be tolerant of all religions. But Jesus says, very intolerant and exclusive statement, who do you say Jesus is an important question to wrestle with. Who is Jesus to you? And how we answer depends our eternal future, as the Bible states here in John chapter 3. It says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. What you answer of who Jesus is to you has eternal consequences for your life. The disciples' reply in Mark 8 indicate that there were various opinions about Jesus. Some said John the Baptist, Elijah, other prophets. The talk back then about Jesus was and is that he was some kind of agent of God, but not the Messiah, not the anointed one from God to save his people, not God's Son, not God the Son, God in flesh that walked among them. No, people wanted to think of him as something else. It's kind of puzzling that some thought that he was John the Baptist, especially since John and Jesus many times were together publicly. They were quite different in personality and ministry, John the Baptist and Jesus. So it seems kind of strange that people would confuse them, Jesus and John the Baptist. But that's what people do, right? Make up what they want to believe so that they don't have to deal with the reality and the consequences of believing otherwise. It's interesting to think that if you were to go around asking your friends, hey, what do people say about me? Well, maybe they first might think, why? Did you do something wrong? Or maybe they may think, you know, it's kind of evidence of pride that you're fishing for some kind of compliment or accolades for your life. This is not what Jesus was doing when he asked such a question. He was leading them and helping them to see him for all of who he was. Jesus wanted to know, as they stood in the midst of a place with idolatry and a place where the ruler named the city after himself, what are people saying of me, Jesus says. How are people understanding his teachings, his proclamations? Do they see Jesus for all of who he is? Even in a world that's clouded with other voices, leaders, and teachers that are trying to persuade and influence their hearts. In Jesus' words and his works, he gave every evidence to the people that he was the Son of God, the Messiah. And yet, they did not get the message. Instead of diligently seeking the truth, the people listened to popular opinion, just as many do today. They had opinions instead of convictions, and this is what led them astray. It's important to ask what people believe and say about Jesus Christ. Again, that's why I say this is an important question that we all should wrestle with. Your confession concerning Jesus Christ is a matter of life or death, as I read here in John chapter 3. Life with God or life apart from God. The citizens of Caesarea Philippi back then would say, Caesar is Lord. And that confession might identify them as a loyal Roman citizen, but it could never save them from their sins and from eternal punishment of hell, as the scriptures state. Jesus asked all his disciples personally this same question, as we read here in Mark 8. He asked them, but who do you say that I am? Making it personal. Jesus now wanted his disciples to look deep into their heart and answer his question. Now that they hear what others are saying and trying to figure out, can they come to a conclusion of who Jesus is? And listen, by redirecting the question that Jesus did here, most likely it implies that Jesus was expecting a different answer from his disciples. So Peter answers, "You are the Christ." He was bold in his answer. And this is what we come to learn about Peter. He's sometimes bold and brash at times. You know, but he wants to follow and submit. Maybe sometimes not always thinking through everything before he says something, but he's bold. And we read in the book of Matthew chapter 16, this same account when Jesus asked his disciples, who do you say that I am? And it states there that Peter boldly confesses him as Messiah. And Jesus said, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven has revealed it to you. God was moving in the heart of Peter. And when we too come to a realization that Jesus is Savior of our lives, it is God who has revealed this to us. Take note of that. When you say Jesus is Lord and believe that he is Savior of our lives, God is working in you. He is real and working in your life. However, Peter revealed his belief in Jesus as the promised king and deliverer that they were longing for. But the problem was, they had to help them, these disciples, really understand the kind of king Jesus would be. Jesus would not be a conqueror nor a liberator who would free the nation of Israel from Rome. Jesus would be a totally different kind of conqueror and liberator who would conquer sin, free the people from sin's grasp, freeing them from the consequences of sin that leads to death, and give life eternal. And you may be asking, well, why did Jesus strictly tell them not to tell anyone that he was the Christ, the Messiah? Well, it was more for the protection of Jesus' true mission to die on the cross as the Lamb of God who would take away the sins of the world. If people would find out about Jesus' true identity, they might attempt to make him king for the wrong reasons. To announce him as Messiah might result in a political uprising that would do more harm than good. And at this point, the disciples didn't fully understand the significance of Peter's confession, as we'll see and hear later in the next verses. So now let's look at our passage again in Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 31. Here, Jesus explains his true mission. Look at verse 31. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Verse 32. And he said this plainly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke Jesus. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Now, so in verse 31 through 32, Jesus explains clearly, as verse 32 states, he said it plainly to them that he must suffer, be rejected by the religious leaders, be killed, and then 3 days later, rise again. Now, this did not sit well with Peter. Probably the other disciples were a little confused as well, but they did not say anything at first, but not Peter. He spoke up. He's bold and brash, like I said earlier. The message of the Messiah would save people from their sins had gotten lost among the list of social and political evils that they hoped that the Christ, the Messiah, would correct. However, Jesus explained that the Son of Man must die, aligning himself to what John the Baptist proclaimed, that he would be the Lamb of God. And Peter's response to Jesus clearly indicates how difficult it was for people to accept the idea of a suffering and dying Savior. But Jesus came to save people from the destruction of sin and death, not raise Israel up to prominence over Rome. I think Peter may have missed or maybe tuned out when Jesus said, "and would rise 3 days later." You would think that would bring some comfort, but probably it just brought more confusion to Peter and the other disciples. 1 minute, Peter was led by God to confess his faith to Jesus Christ as the Messiah, and then the next minute, he was thinking like an unbelieving man and expressing the thoughts of Satan. This is a warning to us all that when we argue with God's word, we open the door to Satan's lies and deception to enter into our minds, enter into our lives. I can understand some of Peter's thought process, and his heart was to protect his Lord, but God's ways are much higher than our ways. God asks us to trust him, obey his word, have faith in him alone, not in faith in other systems and ways, not to allow the world or the culture or other influences, even our own fleshly desires, to lead us, but for God alone. If you go against God's word, his very word, you do open the door to allow the evil one to deceive and lead you astray, away from God's plan for your life. It is God's very word and his spirit in you that brings life, that brings hope and guidance throughout everything you go through. When you believe and trust in Jesus, there will be times when you cannot explain the peace that you have. But you know that God is with you. because he says it in his word. You know that there are promises from God that are true because of what he says in his word. God's word brings clarity, comfort, guidance to our lives. Look at the words of Jesus, where he said here, Jesus said, I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you're going to have tribulation, Jesus said, but take heart, I have overcome the world. That's the peace that he gives. And other times in the scripture it says that he'll give a peace that's beyond our understanding. We can't explain it, but it's there that he gives, and it comes from him alone and his word. It's what brings clarity into our lives. So back to Mark 8, verse 32. We read, Peter took Jesus aside and began rebuking him. Could you imagine doing that to Jesus? Taking him aside and saying, Jesus, let me tell you a few things. I don't think this is right. Maybe shaking the finger and pointing at him. As I shared earlier, Peter was bold and brash. It seems he was a kind of person that would just do what came to his mind, not always thinking through before doing. Can you relate? I know I can. There are times I've been like Peter. And Jesus didn't dismiss Peter, nor did he just ignore him and thought, Peter doesn't know what he's saying, and just don't even address him. No, he did address him. And I believe Jesus rebuked him for his betterment, for his refinement. Jesus cared for Peter, and so much so, he rebuked him so that he didn't stay in this mindset that he was in control, or it's his ways that were going to lead and guide him. I think about Proverbs chapter 3 when I think about Peter and what happened here, and it says, for the Lord corrects those he loves. He disciplines us for those he loves. Just as the father corrects the child in whom he delights. That's what the Lord does. And sometimes we need the correction of the Lord. We need his word to bring clarity and help when we have gone astray. Peter needed that from his Lord, and the Lord didn't ignore him, but rebuked him. He was serious, but to help Peter follow in God's ways. And Peter's protest was born out of his ignorance of God's will and also out of his deep love for the Lord. One minute Peter, you know, was the rock, and the next minute Peter was a stumbling block. Peter did not yet understand the relationship between suffering and glory. And again, we cannot think Peter was the only one that was confused and thinking that this should not happen to the Messiah. When we read in verse 33 here, Jesus turns and sees his disciples, it states there, indicating that they had the same look as Peter was expressing, but they didn't say anything. Jesus may have been addressing all of them indirectly as he rebuked Peter. And as Jesus stated, he was not setting his mind on the things of God, but on man. He was thinking in his own ways and plans and not trusting on God's higher, bigger, and perfect plan. That they may not seem to make sense at first, but it is the best to accomplish a greater purpose. And what Jesus was trying to accomplish and what his true mission was, it was for our salvation. And we know later, right, that Peter would eventually learn this important lesson that Christ had to suffer and die and then rise from the dead for the salvation of our lives to God. Because we read in Peter's first epistle to the church, his letter to the church, we read in 1 Peter chapter 1, he emphasizes how we are born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Peter eventually gets it, but here he wasn't sure. Now we read in these next verses that Jesus calls the crowd. And most likely the crowd was following at this time because they saw miracles that Jesus did and wanted the same. And then he also calls his disciples to learn now an important truth, what it means to follow him. Look at verse 34 through 36 here. And it says, "And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them," all of them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul?" Now Jesus explains further here why for such a rebuke to Peter and the others who have maybe been thinking the same as what Peter expressed. Jesus explains the cost to follow him. There are two requirements Jesus lays out here, especially in verse 34. The two things that he asks in following him is first, denying self, and the second, take up one's cross. The first one, denying self, saying no to selfish interests, those things that lead to sin and wrongdoing, to rebel against God's truth. Denying self is when we surrender ourselves to Christ and set our minds, more so, no, our hearts on obeying his will. It's not about just giving up certain activities or giving up certain foods, whatever. Denying self is a complete attitude adjustment, a heart change to surrender to whatever God says to do and be. Jesus was not teaching that one should deny one's own personality, nor to deny the needs for your physical body like food and water. Other religions like Buddhism and Taoism teach that one should empty themselves of all desire, even physical desires like food, in order to reach some kind of enlightenment. This is not what Jesus was teaching here when he said, deny yourself. Rather, what Jesus taught of the denial of self was turning away from idolatry of self-centeredness, turning away from looking at oneself for the answers and to look to God. It is not just doing what feels right, but following God's truth even when it's difficult, even when it's hard in life. Trusting that God's ways are the best for your life, not our human concepts of truth that we may make up. To put aside selfish ambition and surrender to God's plan for your life. This is the key of denying self. The one who denies self turns self-centeredness into God-centeredness. Let me say that again. The one who denies self turns self-centeredness into God-centeredness. You think about him. You focus on him. And that's the priority. And then we read in the second part of verse 34, take up his cross and follow Jesus. To shoulder one's cross was a vivid illustration of humility and submission, Jesus asked of his followers. When Jesus used this picture with his followers, taking up their crosses to follow him, the disciples and the people of that time knew exactly what Jesus was referring to. Death on the cross was a form of execution used by Rome for criminals. A prisoner carried his own cross to the place of execution, signifying their submission to Rome's power. Thus, to take up one's cross was to demonstrate publicly one's submission, obedience to the authority against which he had previously rebelled. And Jesus said, to follow him, you must take up one's cross. I am grateful that Jesus carried the cross for me, for my rebellion and sin towards him. This is identifying with him and submission to Jesus. First, agreeing that we are sinners towards a holy God. And we need grace and mercy from God to be the people of God that he desires us to be. And Jesus was the example for us in taking up one's cross. His submission to God's will is the proper response to God's claims over self-claims, over self-centeredness. For Jesus, it meant death on the cross to be the payment for our sin debt. This does not mean, though, and I will say this, for those who follow Jesus, it means whatever comes to them, this is what God's will is for them, they must bear. Now, this does not mean suffering as Jesus did or being crucified as he was. You'll never have to bear the sin of the world as Jesus did, for his sacrifice was the final sacrifice for our sins, as it says in Hebrews chapter 12. However, taking one's cross is obedience to God's will as revealed in his word, accepting the consequences without reservations for Jesus' sake, to honor him with your life, and upholding the gospel of Christ that saved your life from sin and death. This may include physical suffering or oppression from others because of your faith in Jesus, but it is worth it. Because in the end, those who believe and follow Jesus are victorious, have hope everlasting, something that the world could never give to us. And Jesus explains further what this means with the next four statements that we read in verses 35 and 38. These verses explain what's really at stake when you follow Jesus. So look at verses 35 and through 38 there to the end of this chapter. It says, "For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake in the gospel will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in glory of his Father with the holy angels." Jesus makes it clear and says some strong, very strong statements here in these verses. One who decides to maintain a self-centered life in this world by refusing Jesus' requirements will ultimately lose his life to eternal ruin. But on the opposite, if a person who will lose their life, give over their life, deny themselves in loyalty to Jesus and the gospel by accepting his requirements, denying self, taking up your cross, will actually preserve your life forever. We'll have life with God forever and ever. Verse 36 and 37 are penetrating rhetorical questions by our Lord that have supreme value and eternal consequences. Look at them again. Verse 36, "For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul?" The answer is simply nothing. We cannot save our soul on our own. We who the Word of God says are sinners, we all fall short of the glory of God. We can never do enough good to outweigh our bad. And you can have all the wealth, all the material things that this world can offer, but it will never make you right with God. You can never use it to buy your way into heaven or make yourself look better to God in order to have a right relationship with him. It's only through Jesus Christ that we can have a relationship with God. He is the only way to have that forever relationship with him. And Jesus, he drew a line in the sand. Who will you live for? Will you live for self? Or will you live for Jesus, the Messiah, the Savior of the world? What will you build your life on? Will you build your life on God's word or on your word? Verse 38 says a very profound statement. It says, "Whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in glory of his Father with the holy angels." Jesus again said it clear. If you're ashamed of him, he'll also be ashamed of you when he comes again. And when he comes again, he doesn't come to save, but the Bible says he comes to judge. However, God has given us this time that we have now to be saved by him if we turn to him and follow Jesus. Rejecting Christ may help us escape shame or feelings of rejections from others for a time, but it will guarantee an eternity of shame later, where the God of the universe would turn away from you and you will be forever separated from him in eternal punishment. But God loves you and does not want you to perish. I hope you hear that today. Not just that God is a judge, and will come back one day to judge us, but he loves us now that he gives us an opportunity to be saved so that we would not perish, but have everlasting life with him. When you repent, when you turn to him and give your life fully to him, that's why he gave us his word, the Bible, so that we could know him and his Holy Spirit to live in us, to guide us. God loves you, and he is worth living for. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Again, nothing compares to being in relationship with Christ. You know, I can only imagine how these words of Jesus hit the disciples' hearts back then when they heard them from the very mouth of their Lord. I think it was a wake-up call to what he was really calling them to completely trust him, even when it doesn't seem right, to completely trust him and his plan, even if it wasn't exactly what they thought. I bet Peter was a little shaken when he got this rebuke, but I think it moved him to surrender. When you come and you see the Lord for all of who he is, it may at times shake you, but I tell you, it could also move in you, in your heart, to knowing that he is for you. He's not against you. And he wants that forever relationship with you. And as we know the rest of the story about Peter, he did move to surrender his life completely to Jesus for the sake of the gospel, even being martyred for his faith by the Romans. He gave it all. He gave it all. So my charge for you today is to deny yourself, take up your cross, surrender to Jesus, and follow him. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you that you've given us this so that we can know about you. And as we learn through Peter's eyes and through the disciples here, how you treated them and helped them to see the greater purpose and plan that you had, that you came to suffer, to die, and then rise again for us so that we wouldn't be separated from you but have a forever relationship when we believe. God, thank you for moving forward and helping even stubborn men like Peter and stubborn men like myself to understand this, to reveal yourself to us. Thank you, O Lord. You are a good and gracious God. I pray that all who hear this, Father, would grow closer to you and follow you, to take that step, to follow you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in his grace. God bless you. I come.
Bowing near, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart.